Well, feel free to pick up those conversations again at the end of this service. Maybe you just want to keep talking about holidays. I love holidays. Holidays are so great, aren't they? Because who doesn't love pulling up stumps for a few weeks, maybe heading somewhere warmer, maybe going to the coast, maybe going to the country if that's your sort of thing. But at the end of the day, who doesn't love a good holiday? And it's great to remember our holidays as well, isn't it? How many of you have gone on a holiday, or maybe you've been in the city, or maybe you've gone to like a Sky High or a touristy sort of place, and you've seen one of these gizmos, these little OH&S little puppies, a little selfie stick, tourists using this device to try and get the ultimate selfie. We love to capture little memories along the way and immortalize them in little digital files that we like to share on Facebook and make everybody else envious of our holiday experiences. Maybe you like to compile and collate these digital files and turn them into a photo book like the old-fashioned days. We love to remember and reminisce over our holiday experiences. We love to capture, to record, and to remember our holidays. Well, with this in mind, spare a thought for an Irish dad called Joseph Griffin, who borrowed his son's GoPro to record all the highlights of a dream trip that he was taking with his wife to Las Vegas. Joseph was intending on recording video footage showing all the sights and sounds of Las Vegas. The only problem was that Joseph's son didn't tell Joseph how to use the GoPro. And so instead of having the GoPro camera facing forward and sort of showing all of the sights and sounds of Las Vegas, he had it in selfie mode. And so this literally, when he gets back from his holiday, all he has is footage of his face. You should YouTube it, maybe you've read about it in the paper. You should definitely view the footage. It's hilarious, this Irish dad. This footage was uploaded. This is what he is, dad's tech fail as he records holiday in selfie mode. It's very, very funny. Maybe you've seen it. His son uploaded the footage to YouTube just last week. In just over 7 days, it's gotten like over 7 million views. So it's gone viral. It's gone around the world. Now, you've got to feel a little bit sorry for Joseph, though, don't you? Because he didn't have the experience or the correct instruction on how to use this GoPro camera. In short, Joseph didn't have the wisdom, and he wasn't supplied, and he wasn't equipped, sorry, to do what was needed to be done. In this case, to simply have the camera just like facing forward, facing the right way. Now, I don't know about you, but I can relate to Joseph's predicament a little bit. I haven't accidentally shot in a selfie or anything, but ask yourself these questions. Have you ever tried assembling a flat pack bookshelf from IKEA without the instructions, and you end up with sort of 10 spare screws and a spare shelf somehow? You don't quite know how you ended up with that. Or maybe have you ever found yourself driving somewhere where you think you're going in the right direction, and all of a sudden you find yourself lost because you haven't looked up the directions, you don't have reception on your phone, and you are too stubborn to pull over and ask for directions or asking for help on which way to go? In those times, wouldn't it be great to have someone who's either handy with the screwdriver and reading instructions, or maybe even someone with excellent navigational skills to help out and give some guidance? Wouldn't it be great to have someone there with the wisdom and knowledge to help you know what to do next? But we're just sort of talking shallow level stuff. What about the dilemmas we face, which are far more important than a misbuilt IKEA shelf or getting lost while driving? What about the times when we face a dilemma that pits our faith in Jesus against the reality of the world in which we live? As followers of Jesus, how are we supposed to live, act, and respond to dilemmas and issues which might come up around topics such as suffering, or maybe sex, or maybe money, or maybe power? In those moments, wouldn't it be great to have someone there or be surrounded by people with the wisdom, knowledge, and experience to help us know what to do next? How are our faith lives meant to respond to the dilemmas of life? Well, the letter to the Hebrews addresses some of these very questions. In many ways, this letter, as you've heard throughout the last couple of weeks, this letter is almost like a bunch of sermons written to a specific group of people who appear to have been facing dilemmas themselves. Hebrews addresses topics of suffering, of sex, of money and power, and are all given perspective in light of who Jesus is. This letter of sermons is intended to serve as an encouragement to a discouraged group of Christians who are seriously, seriously considering opting out of regularly gathering with other believers. Some people in this group are even doubting whether Jesus is as legit as they thought he originally was. So the two main goals that the writer has in this letter of sermons to the Hebrews is this. Firstly, to elevate Jesus, as being better than anything else that this world can provide. And as a result of that, the second objective of this writer writing this letter to this bunch of Christians is to urge and to strongly encourage this group of believers to press on in their faith lives as Christians together. Now, last week, Chris unpacked what it means to be fully sold out as a follower of Jesus. And he particularly looked at how we, as followers of Christ, can do trouble well and come through tough times, both individually and as a community, stronger and better, not bitter. Tonight, as we wrap up our series, our Press On series in Hebrews, we're going to be looking at how our desire to follow Christ is practically shown through our faith lives. Faith lives, it's how we live as followers of Jesus. Our faith lives are how we live as followers of Jesus. And so tonight we're going to be quickly looking at what faith lives look like, but then the even more important question is, how are our faith lives inspired and perfected as followers of Jesus? But before we begin, let's pray that our minds might be informed, that our hearts might be touched, and that ultimately our lives might be transformed for the better. So would you pray with me? Jesus, we thank you so much for our time here this evening as we open up to a letter that you inspired to be written to a group of Christians. We pray that you would quite specifically challenge us on what it looks like to live a life of faith. And in your name we pray. Amen. Well, if you've got your Bibles with you, or you've got a phone or an iPad, flick to Hebrews chapter 13. We are in the last chapter of this letter. Now, have you ever been trying to have a phone conversation with somebody and you realize that you've got 3% battery left? And you're starting to worry a little bit because there are very, very important instructions that you have to give this person. Maybe it's bank details, maybe it's directions to a place. But you've got 3% of battery to share all these main points that you need to tell this person. Well, that's what the first couple of verses are like in Hebrews chapter 13. In the first couple of verses, the writer picks up on themes that he's already covered about how our faith lives were meant to be lived, what we should do, and what we should be wary of as Christians in a community. Fee mentioned a few weeks back, and it was an amazing sermon about how we were not made to do this Christian life on our own. We were made to do life with Jesus and with others. We were made to know and be known. We were made to love and be loved. And so in the opening three verses of Hebrews 13, the writer summarizes content that he has previously mentioned. As followers of Jesus, our faith lives are meant to be marked by brotherly and sisterly love. Our faith lives are to be marked by hospitality and empathy, showing love and care for and serving not only our mates, but also the stranger, the marginalized, and the oppressed. Our faith lives are intended to literally put ourselves in the shoes of those on the fringes of our community and to be advocates for them. Now, one of the issues facing the Hebrew Christians were influences and pulls from the world which caused followers of Jesus to drift away from lives of faith. Chris did a sermon a couple of weeks ago around drifting. Ripper sermon. You should definitely YouTube that as well. But in this passage here tonight, the writer to the Hebrews focuses in on what one scholar refers to as the perennial storm centers of the Christian faith: sex and money. These are the two things which all too often cause followers of Jesus to drift away and shipwreck their faith lives. And they appear to have been an issue of concern for the Hebrew believers. And so very, very quickly, on the topic of sex, the writer exhorts the Hebrew Christians to give honor to marriage and warns of the dangers for those who stray outside of the boundaries of sexual intimacy within marriage. And then he flips over on the topic of money. This is what he says. He says, don't love money, but be satisfied with what you have. And the writer shows, through the use of Old Testament passages in the Bible, the promise of God's constant presence, which is the secret to contentment and satisfaction regardless of our financial situation, regardless of any situation that we find in life. God's constant presence. And so therefore, our faith lives can be marked by confidence and contentment that God will help and supply our every need. So in these first six verses, the writer to the Hebrews has presented a snapshot of what faith lives looks like. It looks like brotherly and sisterly love. It looks like hospitality. It looks like empathy, care, and service for the marginalized and oppressed. Faith lives look like honoring marriage. And faith lives look like contentment instead of love for money. It gives us a very clear picture of what our faith lives look like on paper. But what does this practically look like in real life? How does this transfer to our day-to-day lives? How are we supposed to actually have faith lives that are not only informed by what the Bible says, but are actually inspired by real life? And the writer to the Hebrews addresses this in his very next line. He writes this: remember your leaders who taught you the word of God. Think of all the good that has come from their lives and follow the example of their faith. Faith lives are inspired and mentored by those who are just a little further down the track than the rest of us. We observe and we learn from and we imitate those who have had a position of leadership in our lives, those who have spoken into our lives and modeled the faith. Consider for a moment who is just slightly ahead of you in the faith journey. Who are those people that may be a little bit older than you who inspire you with their faith lives? Who are those people and how do they inspire you with their faith lives? Who are the people whose faith lives inspire you? For Zoe and I, probably one of the most beneficial relationships that we have ever had while we were together was with the couple who mentored and counseled us all through the stage while we were dating. Michael and Kim, they had the kind of marriage that we both looked at and we both thought was just a great example of God's vision for marriage. The way that they loved each other, the way that they loved their children, and the way that they lived on mission constantly as followers of Jesus was a real inspiration for Zoe and I. And it was through their wisdom and it was through their guidance and it was through their example of their own faith lives that I think really helped Zoe and I get to that stage of going, yeah, let's get engaged. And then, yeah, I can live with you for the rest of my life. Very, very crucial in that very, very important decision making. Now, one of the incredible blessings that we have here as Syndal Baptist Church, it struck me from almost the first day that I walked in to this place at the start of the year. There are men and there are women who have lived faith lives consistently and enduringly for many, many years. And the reason that many of us are here today, and the many that many of us are meeting here in this building today, is because of the direct influence of the people who have gone before us and are a little further down the track than we are. Who are the people whose faith lives inspire you? Because they give us an incredible picture of what our faith lives should actually look like. But on the flip side is this little nugget. Who are the people that your faith lives inspire? Maybe you lead in our tribe's kids programs. Maybe you lead in our Fuel Youth programs. Do you have younger brothers and younger sisters? Do you have cousins? Do you have people in your life who look up to you and your faith life? And this is not just restricted to you having to be older than somebody. Who are the people who are maybe just a little ways back on the track of living life as a follower of Jesus? Maybe they haven't come from as solid a Christian upbringing as you. Maybe they've just started their faith journey just a little bit later than you. We have an incredible, incredible opportunity to inspire other people's faith with our own. Our faith lives are inspired and guided by others just as much as our faith lives inspire and guide others. Let me say that one more time. Our faith lives are inspired and guided by others just as much as our own faith lives inspire and guide others. And this is one of the greatest benefits that comes from living in and amongst other followers of Jesus in Christian community. It's that we not only get to be influenced by others, but we get to influence others. There's this awesome little mess of just people influencing each other, hopefully for the better. Faith lives are inspired in community. Faith lives are inspired in community. But a little tension arises out of this truth. Because can anyone think of a leader, or can anyone think of a mentor, or can anyone think of a friend who lives their faith perfectly all of the time? Does anyone really know someone that good that their faith life has been consistent every second of their life? The answer is, of course, no. Because despite our endeavors to live a life following Jesus, there are inevitably times that we're going to drop the ball, where we're going to stuff up, where we're going to muddy our image. So the question is, what are we supposed to do in those moments of failure? Because you have people who look up to you, and yet you feel as if you're completely and utterly failed. Your faith life is meant to inspire and guide others, and yet you know that deep down it's a shambles. Maybe on the surface your faith life is just getting a pass mark, but under the surface it is wounded, it is bruised, or maybe it's even dead. Maybe it's resentment at somebody, maybe it's porn, maybe it's debt, maybe it's a self-esteem issue, maybe it's a desire to want to go to that next level of the socioeconomic sort of demograph, and you'll do anything it takes to get there, no matter the cost. Or maybe it's something that nobody else knows about you, only you. Maybe tonight there are some of us who are sitting here, and you are an inch from throwing in the towel and condemning yourself because of what you've done. Or maybe tonight you are an inch from giving up on your faith life of following Jesus because the weight is just too much to bear. If we are brutally honest with ourselves, we all feel this way at one time or another. And so what are we to do when either we fail or those that we look up to fail? What are we to do when our faith lives are ultimately shattered by either our sin or the sin of others? What are we to do and who are we to look to for inspiration and guidance in our faith life? And the answer to that question lies in who Jesus is and what Jesus has done. See, Jesus lived this perfect life, fulfilling all the standards required for a man to be in right standing with God. And then Jesus did the unthinkable, giving his own life as a means to take the punishment that we deserve so that we could might be able to have a restored position of right standing and connection with God. This is what we call grace. And grace is the catalyst which makes our faith lives perfect in the sight of God. In Jesus, our faith lives are perfected. And this has been the thrust of the entire letter to the Hebrews. Jesus is the only hope. Jesus is better. Jesus is superior to anything else in this entire world. When it comes to inspiring, guiding, and anchoring our faith life, Jesus is the only hope that we have in continuing to press on in the faith. Do you believe that for yourself tonight? Do you believe that Jesus actually can perfect our faith life? Do you believe that Jesus can do the same for you and me today? In support of Jesus being the constant perfecting source of strength and hope in our faith lives, the writer to the Hebrews says this: Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And it is through Jesus' consistent and constant and never-changing power and his incredible grace, which is always extended for us, that our faith lives are perfected. And this power and grace is available to us here today. In God's infinite wisdom, and sometimes I don't get it, but in God's infinite wisdom, he decided that our faith lives would be cultivated best by being surrounded by other people whose own faith lives serve to inspire us. Faith lives are inspired in community. But God also knew that the example of flawed leaders and the tendency that we all have of stuffing up wouldn't be enough for our faith lives to be sustained. And so he sent his son, Jesus, whose power and grace perfects our faith life and enables us to press on. Faith lives are inspired in community and perfected in Jesus. Faith lives are inspired in community and perfected in Jesus. And so I just want to ask a question tonight. Is where are you this evening? Where are you at? Is your faith life firing or is it failing? Is it alive or is it dying? Wherever you are, what should our response be in light of this? Well, the writer of Hebrews suggests a couple of things as we continue through this passage. Firstly, he tells us that we should go to Jesus. We can go to Jesus knowing that no matter how much we've messed up or how deep of a hole that we're in, the grace that Jesus extends to us works to perfect our faith. Not only that, but we are promised of Jesus' continuing presence in our lives as this process works. Our faith lives are perfected in Jesus. And secondly, it means going where Jesus goes. Because following Jesus is a call that draws us away from earthly comforts and assurances in order to pursue a life of faith. Faith lives follow Jesus outside the normal areas of life to where the action is. Faith lives put us in contact with people that are on the margins and fringes of society, and always, faith lives always lead us in to Christian community. Our faith lives are inspired in community and perfected in Jesus. Can you imagine what God might do here in Syndal Baptist Church? What God might do if we all live faith lives that are perfected by Jesus and that are inspired by those around us. I mean, what would our kids and youth ministries look like? How would our relationships and connections at home or in the workplace, how would they flourish if we all lived faith lives which were continually being perfected by Jesus and were continually inspiring others? This sort of faith life can only occur out of an intimate and real connection with and focus on Jesus. And so what does it look like to press on in the faith? Well, following Jesus leads us to pursue a faith life that has an eternal perspective. The final verse of our passage tonight says this: For this world is not our permanent home, but we are looking forward to a home yet to come. Following Jesus leads us to pursuing faith lives with heaven in mind, with the end in mind. And one of the greatest descriptions that I've ever think I've heard that describe people with this sort of attitude, with heaven in mind, is that of a pilgrim or pilgrims, people who are on a journey to a holy place. We live our faith lives now in anticipation of what is to come. And the challenge for us is whether or not we will press on in our faith lives now as followers of Jesus in excited expectation of what is to come. Will we press on in our faith lives, being inspired in community and perfected in Jesus? Will we press on? The band is about to come up and lead us in a song which talks around the process of us living our faith lives with our focus on Jesus. And in this song called Shepherd, describing Jesus who guides and perfects our faith lives, one of the lines says this: "And your presence is the promise, for I'm a pilgrim on a journey." And so as we sing this song tonight, my hope is that these lyrics, that we would sing these lyrics as a response, as a confession, as a declaration to Jesus, asking him and inviting him to perfect our faith life as we follow him. Let's quickly pray. Hey, Jesus, we thank you that you continue to perfect our faith as we seek to follow you. Would you continue to remind us of your incredible, incredible grace as we at times succeed and at times fail? Thank you for not only giving us your presence, but also the presence of those around us to perfect and to inspire our faith lives. Jesus, would you help us to live more consistently for you? And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.